May I borrow someone's House of Leaves?
Oh,
thank you.
Throw it!
Let's start at the very, very beginning, or one beginning. This is from the notes by Zampino at the back of the book. July 27th, 1991. Make no mistake, those who write long books have nothing to say. Of course, those who write short books have even less to say. August 7th, 1992. How did I end up here? I know, of course, I'm referring to the itinerary I followed, but that hardly helps me understand the whys any better. I still walk out into that dusty courtyard and stand amazed. Amazed that I should have ended up stuck in such a shithole. And then I think to myself, not only did you end up here, you're gonna die here too. Of course, Hollywood is the land of the blind with churches for the blind, so in my case it makes a certain sense. You think I'm bitter about being here? Yes? You think I am bitter about this grave I live in and that bed of weeds I scratch around in? You think I am bitter about dying? What do you know? You know nothing about bitterness because you know nothing about love. Get out. Get out. No, 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 stay. Please stay. Let us read something. Forget everything I just said. It's not so bad. I'm just old and you know a good deal about love. And I would like to think I know something more because of my age. Let us read something. So it's a little tricky reading from volume 3. I have to do a little dance. I don't want there to be too many spoilers. So I thought I would stick with a theme. Maybe one of you can guess that theme later on. So I'm going to read from a Xanther chapter. Xanther is the 12-year-old girl who found the very, very little kitten. And this is called Hyperion. My being can never be washed away. Lone Wolf and Cub, Volume 3. Most dads, when they get a day off to spend with their 11-year-old kid, especially when it's like August, and not far away from that kid's birthday, which is like in September, they go straight to Anaheim for Mickey, or to Magic Mountain for X2, or at least the Arclight for a Pixar flick, or at the, like, very, very least, they go to a mall. Dove had taken Xanther to a sewage treatment plant. He was on some kind of recruitment training assignment at Fort Irwin, near Barstow. And he drove like 3 hours to pick up Xanther at 7 a.m. Though for Dove, getting up at 4 a.m. was pretty much like sleeping in. Even before she'd climbed into his Jeep, the questions started pouring out. Who was Irwin, and did Fort mean like the ones in John Wayne movies they'd watched together? And did the Mojave Desert have sand dunes? And what's a brigade combat team, or even just a brigade? And how does a division mean a bigger thing if its name means divide? And what had Dove done so far? Like yesterday, was he outside of the fort on the sand dunes shooting things? To which Dove chuckled and shook his head, and it took Xanther the rest of the drive to figure out that he'd gone to the dentist. Xanther didn't like going to the dentist. Do you know why we floss, kiddo? Dove had asked. To get the gunk out? To disrupt the colonies. Colonies? What's called plaque, a sticky stuff that builds up and attacks our teeth. Now trust me when I tell you, young lady, teeth are something you want to take care of. They're these rare white things that give us pleasure throughout our life and give us bite. Our inheritance, our means of survival, our right to rule. Their enamel is the front line, and that line needs to be won every day. Dove's friend, Ralph Cheroni, Char, had orchestrated the tour. He was, as he explained, a wastewater operator, grade 3 solids. He'd worked at the Hyperion treatment plant for the past 2 years, and he was pretty excited about the place, more so when Dove started firing out his own questions. And boy, did he have a lot, getting Xanther wondering if maybe she got her question song from him. Dove didn't stop. Everything from gallons per day, 340 million. That'll fill up the Rose Bowl 3.5 times, Char had answered proudly, and we can still handle 900 million gallons if it's storm time. To service area, whatever's uphill from us, Venice, Santa Monica, Culver City, Beverly Hills, El Segundo, Glendale, celebrities, they flush their toilets and we get it. To odor treatment, shock dosing, to manhole cover pick holes, the maze sewer systems, primary treatment versus secondary treatment, Archimedes screw pumps versus waste centrifuges, to chemical agents versus filtration options, to the use of chemicals, ferric and ferrous chloride, as a settling agent. Is that right? Settling? Verbatim. Char pointed out the on-site cryogenics. See the ice on those pipes? Sometimes negative 300 degrees Fahrenheit and the 5 mile outflow, 180 feet down on the sea floor. Dove asked about biodiversity and ecological dead zones. He asked about sludge reduction, thermoclines, heavy metals, and turbidity. How is she remembering all this so perfectly? Xanther wore a hard hat to protect her head, more like from all the information than from anything falling. She also had to put on a hairnet. Head lice possibilities, Char explained. Some kids we take through here, you know, from some of the schools. That fact about lice, but also the question Char made out of some of the schools, like Belvedere Middle School or Thomas Starr Kane, was alive in her head as they reached the clarifying tanks. There were 36 in all. Char paused by final clarifier 5E, another 16-foot deep circular tank with clear water running over metal teeth before being sluiced over to pumps that took it all out to sea, 5 miles out. One gull perched curiously in the center. We're going backwards here at your dad's request. Next up came a first-hand view of the enormous concrete underworks, a labyrinth dense and hollow, lined with pipes. Xanther lost count of the stairs down. Check this out, Char said, pointing back at a concrete hallway that seemed endless. You're looking at 2/3 of a mile straight. Hyperion is the biggest treatment plant west of the Mississippi, 144 acres. They filmed Logan's Run down here, Planet of the Apes, Star Trek, but that's been disallowed since 9/11, so no pictures, please. The digesters came next. Talk about strange. 20 huge eggs suspended underground above concrete cups. 4 stories underground, but they can withstand an 8.5 earthquake. 2.5 million gallon biosolid capacity, 128 degrees Fahrenheit. Anaerobic bacterial processes take about 3 weeks to destroy the pathogens and the resultant methane that we pipe to the scattered good plant next door helps recover 80% of our energy. We're nearly self-sufficient. They took the elevator to W. That's for walkway or wow or way up here, Char said, smiling at Xanther, even if it was a fleeting thing, disconcerted by some whatever Xanther could never guess. Char looked around a lot, like at some old netting near a stairwell because birds flew down into the labyrinth below to build nests. Happy nests can't keep nature out. Or at some orange pipes for flaring off the excess gas. Steam silver and effluent is blue. Or toward a grassy dune place fenced off by the sea where shades of sky flitted and settled, the blue butterfly preserve. Maybe Char just needed something to distract him from the smell, which Xanther had noticed kept getting worse and worse. Those air scrubbers, he pointed out proudly, hardly helped, no matter their bleach, caustic, and carbon. Xanther soon had the sleeve of her shirt pressed over her nose and mouth. Not that it helped much. By the loading dock, it was useless. Xanther even tried squeezing her nose through her shirt. Class A biosolids around the clock. Trucks coming and going. That one there, 79,000 pounds gross. Gross was right. Gross black steaming stuff getting shipped north to some farm in Kern County. Nothing, though, compared to the headworks. Even Dove pinched his mouth tight. Xanther thought she might throw up. Once Dove had told her a story about a dog that wouldn't stop puking. Staff Sergeant Rensley, through the blunt instrument of his voice alone, trained that dog to keep the puke in his mouth and swallow it. Xanther had been 7 at the time when they were living in Athens, Georgia, and she was wetting the bed. The wetting stopped, though never the seizures. No matter how hard Xanther tried to swallow those. Anyway, she wasn't a dog. And besides, if Xanther had thrown up that moment, she wouldn't have swallowed anything. Xanther would have aimed. And not to just splash Dove's shoes, more like chest high, direct hit. Char didn't look so comfortable either, and he worked there. Down in this big gray pillar of a building, he seemed even more distracted, eyes dancing everywhere as he mumbled on more about sluice gates, the 8 blue bar screens, curiously numbered 2 to 9, pointing out in the halogeny orange glow of the place where the mechanical teeth dragged out rags and tampons, plastic wrappings, and all the yickety-yack, don't talk back crap, slats of slanted metal, drooling brown refuse. Biosolids, not shit. Biosolids, not shit, Char kept mumbling as he led them around to the other side, past a pipe labeled foul air, to a hole in the concrete slab floor where all the dark water flowed. Just arriving, still untouched. Raw sewage. Where it all begins, where we should have started this tour, Char sighed, checking his phone, his shoelaces, his watch. Phone again, some greedy fly buzzing their ears. Muscles in Dove's jaw, big muscles too, began to flex. And then the part that Xanther's mom has always hated, what stands for those 2 silver bars that stand for captain, snapped sharply into view. Why the hell do you keep jerking your head around like that? Dove barked. Huh? Oh, sorry, Captain. ADD, I guess. What's that? Attention deficit disorder. That's something diagnosed? No, you hear about it, though, online, the news. It means a short attention span. Char nodded, trying to smile. Like I like to channel surf. It drives my wife crazy. That's poppycock. You ain't got no disorder. You just got afraid somehow. Wow, did Char sag then. Like a poked balloon too sad to pop. Talk about how badly he wanted to look around then. But he didn't. ADD's just a fancy name for a scaredy cat, Dove continued. Trying to see what's coming after you. Or trying to not see what's coming after you. Private First Class Chironi, I know you better than that. You're no Frady K. Get back in your skin. Look steady and walk ready. Yes, sir. Later, when Dove stepped into a restroom, Char had whispered to Xanther, I actually am a scaredy cat, but I'd do anything for him. That means for you, too. Kind of weird. Char even looked grateful after Dove got surly, relaxed, too, and he definitely didn't fidget as much. But before that, back by the hole, Dove had squatted down and turned all his focus on Xanther. Weird as well, because she also began smiling again. Her strength, which she hadn't even realized had slipped away, returned. All thoughts of revenge vomit vanishing. The smell, too. Xanther dropped her shirt sleeve from her face. Alas, relax. You're not afraid either, kiddo. Stare a thing in the eye, know it, and let it know you know it, too, before you let it go. You're a mud. Don't forget it. Xanther nearly shouted, yes, sir, jubilantly, too. Instead, she did something she's only managed a few times in her life. She looked straight back at those flint eyes and didn't stop looking until Dove blinked and even looked away. Had he been afraid? Well, he sure was smiling, winking then, and softening fast, before nodding one last time at the sickening flow running beneath them a few feet away. Awful, kiddo, isn't it? And by all measures of decency, we shouldn't be here. We should be at Disneyland or stuffing buttered popcorn in our yaps. But I don't get to see you so much, what with my line of work, where I go, what I'm meant for, what Char here had the smarts and courage to get out of. Dove looked at his friend. I mean that, Char. You served honorably. I'm proud to have called you one of my men. Before returning to Xanther. So, kiddo, I don't want to waste what few hours we have together pretending the world's some ride with guardrails. I want to respect your time, even though you're 10 or 11. Even though you might not get this now, but maybe will later. Actually, this is where she dropped her sleeve. See? She was getting to it. Oh. So I want to tell you something I know to be true. Tell you something that shapes what I do. And it's not particularly sweet, and some might even say it's a little cruel. If less distracted, Char was back to looking uneasy. There's a lot of talk about unity and oneness, especially that Buddhist bullcrappy, which you'll come across soon enough, as well as that other hippie garbage your mom likes to think she believes in. Anwar, too. Heck, don't get me wrong. I'd like to believe it, too. But the way the world works, that's not what I see. That's not what I know. I've been to China, India. I've walked their roads of enlightenment. But all I saw was disease, destitution, and delusion, and a total disregard for the individual, a regard that makes this country we live in the best there is, a light on the hill, a miracle to the world. So I brought you here this morning to show you unity, oneness, a big mess of everything from the purest water to the foulest excretion the mind can imagine, a population's salivas, defecations, urinations, blood, vomit, and tears, dead rats, dead birds, garbage disposal pulp, drug deals gone wrong, body parts, solvents, things as benign as newspapers and cotton swabs up to perfectly fine, unconsumed food. Probably perfumes, too. Expensive perfumes. You name it, some of it's in here. And what does it make? That's right, kiddo. This. Not so pretty, huh? This is a world without boundaries. This is what happens when there are no divisions. Look at it, Xanther. Breathe it in. Never forget. This is what you get when there is no law. This is what you get when the teeth lose. Of course, if I was writing a self-help book, I'd be up here telling you what I believe. So, the tricky thing about being a novelist, and maybe the uncomfortable part, is actually giving voice to things that you might not agree with. I think if Yeats is right, that out of the argument that we have with others, we make rhetoric, and out of the argument we have with ourselves, we make poetry, then perhaps out of the argument that we have with ourselves, as we're arguing with another who's having an argument with themselves, that's literature. Which is to say, it's messy. There's lots of different viewpoints. There are lots of different voices. There are lots of different perspectives. And they all kind of have a sound in this symphony that we try to catch hold of now and then. So for the last section, I'm going to read from Astair's perspective. Astair is the mother of Xanther, and she got into a little bit of trouble with Xanther, and so she's trying to make it up to her. She has a friend named Abigail, who started to date a man named Toys, interesting name, and he owns a place outside of LA where they train big animals for the movies. And they have arrived, but Toys is late, and only his assistant, Kishel, is there to greet them. Seeing that the second big cage holds only dogs, Astair asks Kishel to direct her toward a restroom. But on her way there, Astair for a moment doubts the way, fears she will have to make do off to the side, squatting behind some tarantula-owned rock, until she spots, across a road and down some steps, just as Kishel promised, the small house. The door's unlocked, no one's in. A gloomy place. Distressed shag maroon carpet disappears to die beneath heavily shellacked bookcases loaded with veterinarian books. The immediate kitchen is a narrow alley of stove and sink, counter crowded with bottles of hydrogen peroxide and tubes of neosporin, scissors too, beside rolls of medical tape and wads of gauze, brown enough to keep Astair from investigating further. On the wall is a critter-gitter clock, time at the service of a lion and a hyena, with an elephant stampeding the second hand. The bathroom is just as overwrought, encrusted with dirt, which Astair determines with a fingernail is no such thing, unless years of hardening have produced this current dark epoxy. Everything else is leopard. Leopard wallpaper, leopard towels, leopard candles, and even a leopard toilet seat. Astair hovers. She also never nears the sink, those smeared faucets. A tarantula-infested rock would have been better. The only thing she touches on her way out is the light switch. Leopard. Is this where Abigail revels in her sweet sweat, semen-soaked entanglements? Astair wants to gag. She's nowhere close to gagging. What could have possessed Abigail to have even crossed the threshold? Is she really this lonely? Astair doesn't even realize how tight her chest has gotten, like a man's fist, she imagines, until she steps outside. Something about the dinginess offends her. Astair isn't even thinking of the jeans and boxers hucked over the hair-matted sofa or the muddy boots on the coffee table. She's thinking about all of it. The stink, for sure, for sure. She sneezes now, twice more, her throat itches, eyes too, allergies. Still better than the way she felt inside, flushed, envious. Envious. Something's at her feet. Can she even call it a cat? What a grizzled thing. Gray with just a glint of green in one eye. The other eye is marble white. Ick. The ear above the ick, ick, is no more than a hole surrounded by spidery threads of flesh. The whole left side is nothing more than a few tufts of ashen hair, except where there is no hair at all. A substantial trench digs alongside the spine, through the ribs, and down into the rear flank, rendering a back leg pretty useless. The tail is just gone. It's mew, or is it a purr, a harsh grate of improbable survival, only stops when nearby, very nearby, just up the hill, crowned in brush, something else unleashes its thunder. Astair feels gripped by the bones, the teeth. What the fuck was that? What Astair has every intention of asking Cashel as she's letting herself through the big gate, only to freeze at the sight of the three Australian shepherds, Gus and Vito and Juno, frozen before that last big cage. Something about that last cage now beginning to dawn on Astair, along with, where's Cashel? Where is Xanther? Dark shapes moving inside, way, way bigger than dogs. Not dogs at all. Astair is sprinting, breath quickening, already breathing way too hard, until she's not even breathing. Another fist in her chest, this one of a much different kind, as Astair reaches the fencing to discover yellow eyes and a swirl of black fur and teeth clicking in low guttural growls. Wolves, five of them. And all circling frantically and shaking their heads repeatedly and lunging out suddenly to snap before withdrawing just as fast to continue circling. And the center of their attention, the object of these attacks, her baby girl, sitting cross-legged, alone, until adrenaline sharpens Astaire's perceptions. Cashel's in there too, with a baton, but cornered by the biggest wolf. No, not the biggest. The biggest has just clamped its jaws on her daughter's arm, twisting to rip it away, rip it off, tear Xanther apart. Mom, Xanther cries, which is when everything goes messy. Adrenaline misplaced, gushing for nowhere now, against conflicting sights and tones. Saliva returns to Astaire's mouth. The beating in her chest slows as her body starts to relax, even if her mind persists in trying to command all of her to keep tensing. Tense still more. Do this something more. Damn it. Mom, Xanther cries again. Come in. Cashel looks just as happy. That second biggest wolf before her, a blur of charcoal and snow, has just rolled over, wanting something from Cashel to play with, while the biggest wolf with Xanther, a blonde billow of heavy shoulders and bright eyes, continues to rip away at what's only a frayed blanket, red, which Xanther playfully withholds until, overpowered, she lets go with a squeal. Aren't they amazing? They are, but they think she's more amazing. Cashel notices it too, especially when Xanther stands up. Immediately, Cashel's attendant, wolf, wheels around to rejoin the pack, fall in behind the blonde alpha, who pays no mind to the rest, paying close attention only to every move Astaire's 12-year-old makes. Only Xanther is oblivious, practically skipping across the cage to meet Astair at the gate. The blonde alpha drops his prize blanket to keep close to Xanther, too close, teeth nearly nicking those fragile heels, even as the pack hangs back, if still tuned to the flitting motion of Xanther's hands, her bobbing head and dancing knees, as if they soon might earn some anticipated reward. She's special, Cashel says later, after Xanther goes off to find the bathroom. I'm partial, Astair responds, her practiced tone of neutrality in effect. You start together, Cashel continues. Is her tone leaking with confession or just curiosity? That's the way you're supposed to start, because I mean, they know me. And then you sit down so you're lower than them or the same height, but not higher, which would make you maybe more leaderish and definitely more of an outsider. But when you're down low and they treat you like part of the pack and they come around and sniff you and even pull at that blanket I let your daughter hold, and then you stand up like I stood up to be leaderish, see? And I kind of moved away, which is when they usually all follow me, except this time only Montana followed me, and it was like Cashel's smile changes. Huh. It was like he wasn't really following, but more trying to separate me and, you know, keep me away. Kind of like the way someone might do at a party, pull someone away so the rest can have a private conversation. Actually, now that I think about it, it was really weird. Xanther's heart is at it again, adrenaline back too. Except this time, instead of confusion, it's all about anger. Cashel has no clue. They just took to her, the young woman continues. I mean, took to her. Did you see at the end how she got up and they fell back like all at once? And Montana left me quick and like even Quasar, the Alpha, healed behind her. I've worked with them for 3 years now and they never do that for me. Not even toys, Cashel whispers that last part. Not in that way. It's like they knew her. Like she was one of them or all of them. I mean, but in charge, you know? Cashel suddenly chuckles, loud too, abrasively. Man, I must be beat. It sounds like I'm calling your kid a werewolf. All Astair wants to do is beat Cashel. Even envisions a flurry of fists beating her into bruises and pus, though not with Astair's fists, but heavier and calloused and backed up by brute strength and brute experience. Fists she knows too well because they're doves. At least Astair should shout, how dare you fucking take my 12-year-old daughter into a den of fucking wolves without my fucking permission? You dress her up like Little Red Riding Hood too? Are you fucking kidding me? They're a lot like dogs, Astair says instead. The question has the desired effect. Confidence from expertise dispels Cashel's evident unease. They look like dogs, sure, but they're not. See the yellow eyes, the size, and the tails? They never lift the tails above their backside. They're smart, too, way smarter than your average pooch. You have to trick them to do anything. They won't serve any man, ever. At least that's what Toys says. He should know, they only serve the pack. Astair still can't help but see dogs, even if she sees nothing close to dogs. Actually, the only thing Astair can see is red. Before Cashel leaves, still clueless, she again announces that Toys is only minutes away. Traffic. Xanther and Astair are welcome to hang out with the dogs or kick back in the mini barn office. With Xanther out of earshot, backed by the monkeys, Cashel also asks, sotto voce too, that Astair not mention, you know, that thing with the wolves? That thing. There's supposed to be all this release of liability paperwork to fill out, and anyhow, you know your daughter, right? Astair tries to crush every answer, only one between her teeth, grinding away like she so often tells Xanther not to do, though something in her expression still betrays her. Cashel's eyes widen, her youth suddenly too evident on her soft features. You do know I didn't take her in there, right? I was feeding havoc. She was talking to them, and then she just walked in. Later, long after Cashel's dirty white Corolla left in specters of dust, what Astair keeps turning over in her head is not this revelation, but a different warning. Xanther had returned from the bathroom slightly spooked. What's up the hill? Yeah, Cashel had tensed. Don't go up there, okay? Please, don't. Thank you. And now for some questions. I'll answer the one I know you're all dying to ask. Yes, I'm a feminist. Yes.
This will be helpful. I have to figure out how to ask this question without sounding like an asshole.
Be an asshole. Great. Embrace it.
So there's this quote from Familiar Volume 1, which is, I think Xanther and Anwar are talking, and Anwar says, "How thoroughly have we considered this house through its eyes?" Mind reading, she had asked then, looking up at him with those wide, astonishing eyes, one azure, the other hazel, both shot through with speckles of green and gold, each ringed with a blue to rival black. So there's a lot of, like, reference to your other books in that short paragraph, mm-hmm. The color of the eyes from Only Revolutions and, like, a blue to rival black. So I'm just curious, like, what role do your other books play? Like, do your past books play in your new books, if any? Like, is that a conscious thing, or is that just sort of happen because they're in your brain?
First of all, you're going to have to work harder if you really want to be an asshole. I don't think that even rates. I mean, that's... I love the specificity. I wish it just happened. That would be awesome. I could just sit down and go, "Poof, it's done." I guess I could be an asshole. And I could say, well, who's saying that? And what chapter is that in? And what perspective, you know, is it coming from? And what are the permeabilities, say, of that particular character's mindset? And what is his or her, you know, capabilities at mind reading? But of course, you know, of course my previous works play a role. Of course, I mean, I think those of you who've read my work know that there is this sort of dance between that which is unconscious, which is probably why you brought it up in your question, and that which is very conscious, which you, of course, already recognize by the nature of your question and what you were sort of parsing in that particular moment. So there is this sort of interplay of when certain vocabularies that resonate in a book, and maybe it's not even a vocabulary word, maybe it's simply a color, can rise to the surface in the familiar and begin to inform it. I do think one thing that's become interesting to me is that there are people who will ask about, say, a reference to House of Leaves or Only Revolutions or the 50-Year Sword. Or then another question will come up about, like, the various pop culture references, you know. And I think part of it is the larger design of the familiar, which is those questions come about because those moments are familiar to you, to the reader. And other moments that are there are more invisible simply because you might not have those set of cultural references. So the larger project, conscious and conscious, unconscious, is to embrace this thing of what we call familiar, of how we find patterns in things, we recognize things, but how that recognition can often blind us to something else that's important. It was funny because when I got in, I had a moment to just take a quick stroll and I heard some incredible things. I heard this mother who was leading these four children along the sidewalk, and one of the children had said something, and she said, "I do not need that voice in my head." And I thought very much of, like, how I totally understood her position, because she has to be focused solely on these four children to make sure that they're okay walking down the sidewalk. But at the same time, she does want to disallow that voice, and how often do we do that? And then I hit another corner, and there was an older woman who was on the phone shrieking, and she says, "If he doesn't want to get in the discussion room, then this marriage is over." And I thought, well, I think that's a pretty good one for the familiar in a way, is the discussion room. We all have to, it kind of places you in the discussion room, and its discussions are within the room of the familiar, but they also, there's some open windows and doors, and so they allow other things to come through. How's that for not answering your question? In the back, the woman, yes, you?
Can you explain to me how you begin to organize your thoughts for something like House of Leaves or something as grand as the familiar? Because I can't begin to imagine it.
I can't either. How do I organize my thoughts, this project? Well, every book is unique. So there was a different way of approaching the organization of House of Leaves. Only Revolutions was very, very different. You know, it had all, you know, thousands of note cards. This was really pre-internet research with all these little, you know, notes on historical moments and vocabularies of the time. And the familiar, again, became its own sort of project. And I guess, do you want the real answer? Yeah. So a lot of it is the craft, and I'll get to that. But the first part was when I was finished with Only Revolutions, I did realize I was at this crossroad. And I had achieved something which every author, at least novelist before me, had in some ways always dreamed about. I had total control. I was able to do this thing and design all the elements, 360 words per page, 360 pages, 36 lines, cross-rhymed, you know, the whole deal, 6 years of just this intense experience, which was endless, and at the expense of everything else. Like the two 16-year-olds who are madly in love with each other on this amazing ego trip through 200 years of history, I too just basically raised everything around me. You know, friendships teetered and relationships, you know, failed. And I realized, like, if I keep going like this, I'm going to end up in a little cabin in Montana thinking I'm writing a great novel when I'm really writing a manifesto about explosives. So I decided that the time had come to open the windows and open the doors. And for those of you who've ever made a life-changing decision and have seen its consequences, but you know that it comes invisibly within you. It's a decision that you make that you know is real and you know will have consequences, but no one else can see it. It's not something you tell anyone else. You just make this decision and you feel part of yourself just shift in a way that changes where you're going to go. Because you do take that other path, and it's still too early for anyone else to see that you're walking that path. But somehow when you do that, the world does change. It somehow recognizes that you are moving in this new direction. And I got this amazing phone call from Steve Erickson, who's a wonderful novelist out in LA. I recommend him highly. And he said, do you want to do a reading at Red Cat? And Red Cat is this amazing theater in the Disney Hall, downtown LA. And I was like, yeah. And I was thinking of this piece I'd written, The 50-Year Sword, which had only come out in Holland. And it's all about, you know, the oral tale, basically a campfire tale. And it has five voices. And I thought, I'll be able to cast it with, you know, different performers. But I was terrified because that meant I couldn't be in that cabin. And I had to work with a lot of people that were going to disagree with me and suddenly different creative stuff. But this was important to me. And so I embraced that. And I think it was on the end of the first week the actors unionized and they wanted, you know, extra edamame in their lunch. So that was hard. And I caved, I have to say. But we finally did. And it was this wonderful, like, just amazing, just group of people that were also very different with different skills, and that began the sort of shift in me. And we did the show 3 years in a row on Halloween, and it was very, very successful. And during that time, you know, Pantheon and I were discussing about how to release it in the United States, and I still hadn't figured out the graphics of it all. And I was at the time dating this woman, and she you know, it was early in our relationship, and she would let me into her apartment, but she would never let me go near her closet. And she said, you can't go in the closet. You can check out the kitchen, the bathroom, sit still in the living room, but you can't open that closet. But it began to worry me, because I thought maybe all her exes were in there on tiny little hooks, you know, and I realized I would have to check. And finally, she did open it for me, and there were little hooks. There was just a wall of spools of thread and swatches of cloth and two sewing machines. And she studied at Parsons and she was a designer, and I suddenly, you know, I knew what the 50-year sword was about, but at this moment I suddenly was like, wait a minute, could I sew some paper right now on your machine? And she said, you're not going to touch my fucking machine. But we ended up getting two machines and a few more eventually, and then, you know, working with other artists, and then we created what loosely then was called the Atelier, and we began to sew the pieces that are part of the 50-year sword. And there were late nights, and, you know, yes, when you stress a machine out when you're sewing paper, and the needles would pop and break and fly across the room. And this is, believe it or not, answering your question about organization. And there were spools of thread. There were just clumps of thread everywhere. And my cat, Carl, was playing with them. And we were going to throw them out. And then I think one of the artists there was like, hey, this is pretty cool. And that was kind of one of those moments of where something that was totally chaotic was sort of organized just simply by the sort of the vibe, you know? It was just like everyone was working. We were like, wait a minute, this is kind of cool. So we collected all of this and the broken needles, and eventually we scanned them, and they appropriately became the end papers for that book. But that process enabled me to go further for the familiar, which I knew in part was about writing something that was just beyond me, that I couldn't organize. See, I could organize Only Revolutions. I had totally conceived of it. But the familiar is all about not me. It's beyond me. Like, I don't know anything about Armenia, so I drive around in taxi cabs talking to Armenian drivers, you know, and hearing their stories, or talking to coders, or talking to people from Singapore, going to Singapore, studying Singlish, all of these things. But it also requires a more robust atelier of graphic artists and whatnot, and we have a big black magnetic chalkboard, and we put up like various sort of graphic conceptions for the splash pages per volume, so we can sort of see how the colors are developing. A dry erase board that keeps track of all the panic. We have, like, you know, a red, which means panic, and that's most of the time. My editor isn't allowed to see that, because it's just these awful eyes of this is all going to fail. And then occasionally we move it up to orange, and that means, oh, wow, we've got an idea. And then eventually I think we move it to green, and that means we're almost good to go. And then blue means it's ready. And I'm writing and laying the whole thing out, and then there is this back and forth with different artists, and the idea is to stay open. So for Jingjing's monster cards, we often use artists from Instagram, for instance, and that's sort of a portal, and if they're interested in continuing work, then that's a way of sort of developing it. But so the organization, yes, comes from me, but it also comes from this atmosphere of people that are concerned about this story and see how it moves beyond one singular voice, one authorial voice, that there's image there, and that there's a sense of, I don't know, sense of something, that something else, I guess, is what it is. And then I'm always learning to reorganize the material and whatnot. And I guess the last thing is just the recognition that I started it. Well, the origins even predate House of Leaves, but I started this, you know, right after Only Revolution. So I worked on it for 9 years. So just that constant work, 6 days a week, up at 5 a.m, on and on, you know, eventually it's you begin to internalize all these rhythms and perspectives, you know. And so that's where we get back to sort of that unconscious part. You know, you create an unconscious that then becomes responsible for part of it. Your animal, I guess, you know. You're familiar.
We have time for about three more questions.
Three more, wow. Okay, yes, right there.
Okay. Right, microphone, testing. Okay, I'm not needing it, good. So this is more House of Leaves, because that's the one I've actually gotten around to, you know, reading. It's a bit of a bear.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
16 years later, you did it.
Well I've done. Actually read it like three times. Until I read it most recently, I wasn't aware you'd done anything since.
Right.
Anyway, that's not like an insult. I was just...
It wasn't. I'm used to it by now, thanks to this guy.
the point I'm getting at was... And I'm kind of giving your own medicine back at you. I promise this is all cohering to something. I play a bunch of video games because I'm like a nerd. And but what's been very distressing to me is that video game kind of culture has, well, strains of it have become really kind of viciously opposed to criticism.
Right.
That drives me nuts because I really like criticizing things. I really like talking about things.
Question is about as long as my answer.
That's my joke. That's the joke. I was telling. The point is, there's this game, Dark Souls, which I'm sure has crossed your ears at some point because nerds like me making references. And there's this secret area, super obscure. You don't need to go to it to beat the game. It's in behind two, fake walls with no clues that those fake walls are there. It's like a fake wall and then another fake wall behind a treasure chest. It's great. And you go down deep, deep through this infested tree and you come out into this lake of ash. And you see all these gigantic trees holding up parallel worlds out forever. Ash trees.
So is that your question?
Ash trees?
Because Kaelin's going to pull the mic fast.
And that always made me think, because I'd read House of Leaves the first time before I played Dark Souls.
Right.
And then I played that, and I'm like, oh, Yggdrasil, I get this. This is great. And Dark Souls is a game I've written about. I like talking about it. And so it's very distressing to me when things that I like talking about, there are people who accuse people of censorship for talking about video games. It's nuts.
Right.
And so my question, I guess, is what a lot of contemporary reviews of House of Leaves described it as a satire of academia.
Right.
And as I read House of Leaves, my interpretation is that that's nonsense. It's a celebration. That the idea of criticism and interpretation is vital to understanding House of Leaves because it's vital to understanding everything. That all art is bigger on the inside. And I'm like, is that what you were going for? I'm pretty sure that was you were going
for.
Are ash trees a metaphor
for art? A satire of academic writing.
I guess.
I think so. Why not? Let's go with that.
Well, my research paper turned out to be entirely wrong. Great job.
I don't believe that.
Yeah. Got a question here?
Sure.
Hi. You've got an expression in one of your characters says, I'd rather shoot myself in the face and live. And it's something which struck me because I often say that I'd rather slit my wrist with a fork than see a Broadway show or something like that. And it's true. But I just wonder.
I'll take your ticket to Hamilton.
You're welcome.
It's fine.
You can have them happily. But I just wondered whether there was a kind of, whether you had any thoughts about that kind of remark. I mean, some people would think that it was slightly negative, you know, or even angry or something. And I wondered if you had any thoughts about that particular phrase.
Or romantic. Yeah, I do. I think the process of change for a personality is very complicated and difficult. But as we get older, we experience shifts in ourselves towards different selves. And we also realize we could walk down different paths and become even much more different. But our older selves can sometimes hold on to who we are. And sometimes the friction of that, you know, in wanting to become something else and sort of allowing that change that's already happening in you can sort of, you know, advocate a kind of violent vernacular or even a violent action. So that it's oneself that's saying, I would rather stab myself, you know, with a fork. But maybe there's another self that really would like to go to some more Broadway place.
One last question.
I just was curious that you're tackling a project that's very complex. I don't know how many of the books you've completed or you have outlined.
Almost four.
Okay.
Four's in for proofing.
So do you find yourself with such a big project feeling like you're running towards something, towards a finish, or have you found yourself going through these books and finding yourself holding back, slowing down, because it's a different kind of ending, it's a different kind of inevitable? Are you
right?
Yeah,
that's a great question. How much of this project is ultimately about reaching the end? There's some of that. I know what the ending is, and I can't wait for the ending. And if ultimately we don't make it that far, it will be heartbreaking that I can't tell you Xanther's story and what happens to this amazing family. And sometimes there's that temptation to kind of not, you know, to hold on to something for volume 13, maybe, right? Just a little bit about the process. The volume one, I ended up cutting 100,000 words from. So that's two Great Gatsbys, right? They were amazing Great Gatsbys, by the way. And then the second one was probably about 50 or 60,000. So there's also a lot of excess. And the third one has been probably 20 or 30,000 words. And in that, the Hyperion sequence with Dove was alive, then it was cut, it came back to life. Finally, I just figured I wouldn't use it. It would just be for me. And then in volume three, it sort of came up as this moment. It was kind of weird how it presented itself. It was like, this is the chapter where she thinks about this moment, about how Dove views the world and how it needs to be divided. And if it's not divided, this is what it's going to end up looking like. And I go into that a little, because what finally happens is each time I finish a volume, even though the series is constantly announcing that it's incomplete and unfinished, it is a finished book. I'm extremely proud of volume three. I think it's probably the best writing I've done to date, you know? And it, even if you don't read one and two, you're gonna have a hard time with three, I'm not gonna lie to you. But there's a lot of it, a lot there. And you know, if you're still obsessed with story, that's great. Story's part of it. But the greater books are always concerned with the story of theme. So in that sense, you settle into it. You settle into the story of teeth, you know? You settle into that story of the pack, into the story of whatever it is. And at that moment, there is no future, there is no past, you know. I'm there with Xanther and Dove, you know. I'm there with Astair discovering her kids in the middle of a cage filled with wolves, you know. And the point about where I'm going is irrelevant. But I think that's how we have to live our life. If we become obsessed with what's not here, we miss what's here. And you're here, and I'm here, and it's a great night. Thank you very much.